Good morning. Our sermon today is entitled, The Swiss Are Wrong. The Swiss Are Wrong. Now, the Swiss aren't wrong about everything. But there's a very vital point that the Swiss are wrong on. Now, Switzerland is nestled in Central Europe and has scenery such as we see here in this slide, the Matterhorn, Lake Luzerne. It's a beautiful lake there in Switzerland. It is some of the most majestically beautiful country you can imagine. I've been to Switzerland. I've seen Lake Luzerne. I've not been to the Matterhorn yet, but I'd sure like to go. But I've seen some of the Alps, been through the Alps in Switzerland. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. It's one of the most beautiful countries in the world as long as you don't insist on having an ocean beach, because Switzerland is a landlocked country. It is the home of the International Red Cross and the Red Crescent that works, you know, especially for the Muslim countries. And so Switzerland seems to be a place that wants to reach out to help others. Traditionally, though, Switzerland has avoided alliances that might entail military, political, or direct economic action, and has been neutral since its expansion in 1515. Its policy of neutrality was internationally recognized at the Congress of Vienna in 1815, and only in 2002 did Switzerland become a full member of the United Nations. Switzerland is not a member of the European Union. The euro is not the main currency there, as an example. The Swiss people have consistently rejected membership in the European Union since it began. This neutrality of Switzerland included World War I and World War II. Even Adolf Hitler, who sent his Stuka dive bombers into Poland and his forces into France and into Belgium and many other places, decided not to attack Switzerland. They had such a strong militia army that he realized the cost would be too great for what he would obtain. And all this sounds good, but is it really good to have neutrality? Was it good? And I go to our next slide. Was it good to be neutral during the Holocaust when millions of Jews, Poles, Russians, and other people were murdered at places such as this, the Beckano? And I have stood at the very place this photograph was taken, inside the Beckano. And this was simply a death camp. It wasn't even a concentration camp. It was a place where people were sent to die. It had one purpose, to put people to death and to dispose of the bodies. Would it be good to remain neutral in a situation like that? I would like to say I think not. No, I know not. Neutrality in a situation like that is wrong. You see, the neutrality of Switzerland does not exist because they have the opinion that there are no absolute rights or absolute wrongs, but rather it is to avoid being in a conflict and suffer loss. Ultimately, it comes down to self-preservation and to preserve property. In other words, stay out of war is better because it costs less, and it even later will make us money. It will make us money later because we will loan our monies out to the countries who are rebuilding now, and we'll make interest. And so ultimately, this comes down to selfish purposes. But is this how the Christian sees life? Does the Christian see life as something that should be done for selfish purposes, selfish reasons, self-preservation? Are we here to give instead of to receive? I say, no, this is not how the Christian sees life. Notice in Luke chapter 11, verse 23, the first part of this verse, Jesus says, "He that is not with me is against me. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth." Do you see a principle here? Jesus is teaching us a principle that should be near and dear to each and every one of us, and that is that neutrality is a grievous sin. You cannot be neutral and be a Christian. You are either for Christ, not 50%, 80%, or even 99%, but we are to be for Christ 100%, or we are for the world, Jesus says. And that is the way it is. But aren't we to tolerate others, perhaps who aren't Christians, or who don't see the gospel as we believe the Bible teaches? Well, the word toleration means to allow the existence or practice without interference. It's from a Latin word, tolerat, mean to endure. And toleration is the virtue of being prepared to accept people and their viewpoints while commended within the church at times. Scripture insists that believers must have a vital concern for maintaining and defending truth. In other words, friends, it's one thing for me to give you full religious liberty to believe what you see as truth or to believe something that's totally not truth. But I still have a responsibility to defend truth and to speak for truth and to denounce error. Toleration should be exercised for the benefit of those at times who are weak of faith. For instance, in Romans chapter 14 and verse 1, Paul says, "Him that is weak in the faith receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations." Sometimes people are weak in the faith and we receive them. They don't see everything. They don't have the convictions. They don't have the strength that we have at this point in our Christian experience. But the Bible says receive them. Welcome them. Try to do everything you can. But then also, it says here in verse 22, he says, "Hast thou faith, have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in the thing which he alloweth." There's a place, friends, where we allow people room. But there are certain bedrock fundamental principles, friends, that we must speak and speak straightly for. And there are certain errors that we must be very careful, that we do not be quiet about. We need to be careful in how we deal with people all the way through, of course. Paul brings out a very interesting principle in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, if we could turn there. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and I dare say if I was to ask you to quote verse 6, probably most of you would be able to do that. "But to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him." And he says, however, there is not in every man that knowledge. But then he goes on, and in verse 8, he says, "But meat..." And meat, we found out Wednesday night in the Bible, is a synonym for what word? Food in general. "But food commendeth us not to God." Well, that's a lesson probably some of us need to learn. You know, food is important, and eating right is important, isn't it? But friends, eating right of itself is not what makes us a Christian, and eating right of itself does not make us better than someone else. "But food commendeth us not to God, for neither if we eat are we the better, neither if we eat not are we the worse. But take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak." Now, Paul's been speaking to these people, and he's been dealing with a very practical, pragmatic issue. And that is that there would be food that would be offered in the markets. And some of this food had been offered to idols, dedicated to idols. And some Christians felt like that they couldn't eat this food. It would be wrong. But you know, the Apostle Paul, he could just eat it with joy. Didn't have a problem one, because he knew that an idol is nothing. And he knew that it didn't affect the biological atoms and molecules of that food a bit. But he said, some people have a trouble with this. But if I start to now make this a big issue with them, if I try to coerce their minds on this, he goes on to say, "For if a man see thee which hath knowledge set at meat or at food in the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols?" Now, Paul says, you know, it's not wrong to eat this food. But he says, here's someone who's got a conscience, and that conscience says, I shouldn't eat this food. And Paul says, they see me do it, and they're going to say, well, I can do it because Paul does it. In other words, we can do the right thing for the wrong reason. Did you get that? We can do the right thing for the wrong reason. It wouldn't hurt to eat the food. But if I'm breaking my conscience because I feel like a man has given me approval as opposed to God, I have violated my conscience, and Paul says that is wrong. He says, "And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died. But when ye sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, ye sin against Christ." So we need to be careful, friends, that we don't wound our brothers, that we don't sin against Christ, that we show a love and a concern for one another. And Jesus always showed concern for others. And I think especially of children. In Matthew chapter 19, verse 13 and 14, it says, "Then were brought unto him, unto Jesus, little children, that he should put his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked them." The disciples rebuked them. The disciples rebuked them. Don't bring these children to Jesus. He's an important man. He's a busy man. He doesn't have time for children. You know, children make noise. Children cry. Children sometimes even wet their diaper on you. But what did Jesus say? He says, suffer little children, and forbid them not to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of heaven. Sometimes we are slow to tolerate children. We may be slow to tolerate others who don't believe like us. We may be slow to tolerate people who we feel like don't move fast enough, or feel like they move too fast, or whatever the thing is that rakes us or turns our screw the wrong way. But we need to love people. But yet, saying all that, we need to keep in mind that evil is something that God does not tolerate in any way. Turn with me to the book of Habakkuk in the Old Testament. Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 13. Here the prophet says, thou art of pure eyes and to behold evil. He's speaking about God. And he says, thou art of pure eyes and to behold evil, and canst not look on iniquity. Wherefore lookest thou upon them that deal treacherously, and holdest thy tongue when the wicked devoureth the man that is more righteous than he? And of course he says, you don't do this, Lord. You take action. You do things. Because you don't behold evil. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 2, Jesus speaking to the church at Ephesus. He says, I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars. He says here that you don't tolerate evil. That which is evil, you won't put up with. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, the Apostle Paul makes it clear that error cannot be tolerated. It says, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. He says, don't let anyone deceive you. So we are not to tolerate this. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, Paul speaks here about certain issues of relationships. But then in verse 3 he says, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, healthy, good words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but doubting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself, but godliness with contentment is great gain. So Paul says there's a place to withdraw yourself from others who do not teach truth. In the same chapter in verse 20, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called, which some professing have erred concerning the faith. I think the Bible is very clear, don't you? In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, Paul says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from hearing the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Peter carries the same theme in 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 1. He says, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in, what's the next word? Damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon them swift destructions. You know, when we deny the Lord that bought us, when we deny that Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, friends, who came to this world and bought us, redeemed us back to God, That, the Bible says, is a damnable heresy. And by damnable, it means one that will bring damnation, condemnation, and eternal loss to you. And so that makes it pretty important. All forms of error, false worship, idolatry, whatever, they are to be avoided. And so true believers cannot accept any and all teachings, or even the people who teach them at times, and their doctrines. The test that we have is in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word. And so everything must be tested by the word of God. And what I'm telling you today, friends, must be tested by the word of God. Now I want you to know some teachings of Jesus in Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. And we want to do a little exegesis, not eisegesis, on this text today. It's really important because it's easy to read into this text. A lot of people do. Luke chapter 9, verses 49 and 50. And John answered and said, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and we forbade him because he followeth not with us. And Jesus said unto him, Forbid him not, for he that is not against us is for us. Now, how do you take these words of Jesus? On the surface, they sound a little ecumenical, don't they? They sound pretty ecumenical. In fact, most commentaries talk about these verses and use them to support the concept of ecumenicalism. I thought you might like to know what the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentary says about these words. Well, here's what it says about these words. Nothing. They have a little comment on 48. They have a comment on 51. But there's no comment at all on 49 and 50. They totally leave it out. I thought that was interesting. But there are others who do comment on. In the New American Commentary on page 294, Robert Stein says this: The practice of excluding others who minister in Christ's name because they're not one of us has been all too frequent within the Christian church. One need only think of the established church and the dissentient or nonconformist church. The church must guard itself against excluding outsiders who believe the carnal tenets of historic Christianity simply because they are not associated with us. Now, in one sense, there's some truth in that. We may be of a church and there may be another church here. Maybe there's a church in California, a church in Iowa, a church in Ohio, maybe another church in the next county over. Maybe we believe all the same things. Then true, we shouldn't try to push away from each other. We should find ourselves in a sisterhood of churches in a situation like that if we truly believe what are the accurate, true, historic, carnal tenets of Christianity, the fundamental bedrock pillars of our faith. In our next slide, Warren Wisby, in his The Bible Exposition Commentary, he states this: They also showed a lack of love for believers outside their own group, speaking of the disciples and making reference to this text. This is what we would expect from a son of thunder, Mark 3:17. Perhaps John was trying to impress Jesus with his zeal for protecting his name, but the Lord was not impressed. Believers who think that their group is the only group God recognizes and blesses are in for a shock when they get to heaven. Now, how do we then view these verses? Well, first of all, we need to look at what the verse is saying, not what we think the verse is saying or what other people say the text is saying. The text does not say that these people that John is referencing to were teaching or believing different things. Did you get that? It doesn't say that they were teaching or believing different things. Sometimes people say, well, you know, you teach this and we teach that, but that's okay. You know, we're all to get together because we're all in Christ's name. But the text doesn't say that they were teaching something else. No, these people were believers who were working under the name or the authority of Christ. Remember that the term name, and if you look up this word name for the name in your Bible dictionaries, you find that even though it's always almost always translated name, it carries the concept of authority. So when I'm teaching in Jesus' name, that means I'm teaching under his authority. But to use the name of Jesus and to say I'm teaching under the name of Jesus is not necessarily teaching under the authority of Jesus. Do you see the difference? In other words, if Jesus gives me the authorization, then I'm teaching in his name. Whether I use his name saying, I'm teaching you today in the name of Jesus, I don't have to come in here today and use that exact enunciation. I don't have to come in here and say to you, I've come in the name of Jesus to teach you in the name of Jesus. A, B, and C. But if Jesus has sent me, I've come in his name, whether that phrase is said or not, right? On the other hand, I can come in here and I can say, by the name of Jesus Christ, I want to teach you this. Or you're sick, by the name of Jesus Christ, be well. But if I don't have the authority of Christ, then I'm not teaching in the name of Jesus, scripturally. Does that make sense? Is that understandable? And so these people that John is speaking about, I believe from the context that they were believers who were working under the name or the true authority of Jesus. But John was a little concerned because they just weren't right in their immediate group. But we must be careful not to ever complain about the authority of Jesus. You know, there was a man whose name was Leo the Tenth. And he felt like he had the authority of Jesus. And he tried to shut up a man whose name was Martin Luther. Was that right to do that? That wasn't right to do that. So sometimes there's a place, friends, where we need to be careful on what we do in trying to shut people down. But the context of the statement of Jesus, if we go back here and look in verse 46, 47, 48 in Luke 9 now, it says, then there arose a reasoning among them, which of them should be greatest? And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a child and set him by him, and said unto them, whosoever shall receive this child in my name receiveth me, and whosoever shall receive me receiveth him that sent me. For he that is least among you all, the same shall be great. And John answered. You see the context, how it's flowing through here? And John answered. And so the context here is pride and self-supremacy. And were these people then casting out devils in the name of Jesus? Again, apparently they were. For Jesus knows the heart of all, and he knows the difference between those who profess and those who fess or confess. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, Jesus says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter in the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied? How? In thy name. In the name of Jesus, we prophesied. And in thy name have cast out devils. Well, that was a problem for John, wasn't it? And in thy name done many wonderful works. Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. You see, friends, Jesus doesn't contradict himself. If he told John, leave these people alone because they're doing a good work. They were doing it. He knows the difference between a good work and a bad work. And he's going to tell those people at the end who are doing the wrong thing, I never knew you. You came using my name. You came professing my teachings, but you did not have my authority, and you did not obey me. Friends, we are not to judge others, but God does. And God's word is the standard. We are not to have multiple opinions. In 1 Kings chapter 18, we have the story of Elijah on Mount Carmel. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21, and Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him, but if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. He says, how long are you going to be neutral about this? That's what he's saying. The Septuagint, an English translation of the Septuagint says, how long will you halt on both feet? You're limping, halting, stumbling. This foot, that foot, which way are you going to be? Going to be left? You're going to be right? What are you going to do? In the spirit of prophecy, we find this statement. What astonishing deception and fearful blindness had like a dark cloud covered Israel. Concerning this time now of Elijah. This blindness and apostasy had not closed about them suddenly. It had come upon them gradually as they had not heeded the word of reproof and warning which the Lord had sent to them because of their pride and their sins. And now, in this fearful crisis, in the presence of the idolatrous priests and the apostate king, they remained neutral. If God abhors one sin above another, of which his people are guilty, it is doing nothing in case of an emergency. Indifference and neutrality in a religious crisis is regarded of God as a grievous crime and equal to the very worst type of hostility against God. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 3, pages 280 and 281. How could you say something any stronger than that? To be neutral, to be indifferent on these important salvational themes, it is being hostile to God. It is the very worst type of hostility to God, and it is called a grievous crime. We need to get rid of jellyfishitis. Do you know what jellyfishitis is? Do you know what a jellyfish is? Nope. It's a backboneless creature, an invertebrate. It has no backbone. That's our problem, friends. We don't have backbones enough to stand up. It's too easy to please people. It's too easy to say smooth things. It's too easy to say sermons that are peace and safety to the congregation. And we need to get rid of jellyfishitis. While we must tolerate and even better give full religious liberty to those who see, even honestly, see scriptures differently than we do, we are not at liberty and must not yoke up with those in whom we have strong fundamental differences of belief, friends. We cannot support their activities and programs. There really is no neutral position. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 30, Jesus says, "He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad." And so we have here a very plain principle that we're really one way or the other. We might think that we're neutral, but friends, when we try to play neutral, we really take the position that Satan wants us to take. And we may not realize that at first, but being neutral takes the position of Satan. In Volume 1 of the Testimonies, we read these words: "Many seem to have no true sense of their responsibility before God. They are required to strive to enter in at the straight gate, because many shall seek to enter in and shall not be able. Heaven requires them to try to induce others also to strive to enter in at the straight gate. A work is before young and old to labor earnestly to save not only their own souls, but the souls of others. There are none who have reasoning faculties who have not some influence." Let me just pause now. In other words, friends, each one of us have a responsibility. Each one of us, we have an influence, don't we? We all have reasoning faculties. Every one of you can understand what I'm saying here today. None of us are imbecilic. And so we have a responsibility in some way, even if it's a small way or a large way. Continuing, it says, "By their indifference, they use that influence to hinder souls from striving to enter in at the straight gate, or by their earnest, persevering, untiring efforts, they urge upon them the necessity of striving diligently to enter there. No one occupies a neutral position, doing nothing to encourage others and doing nothing to hinder them. Says Christ, 'They that gather not with me scatter abroad.' Take heed, old and young, you are either doing the work of Christ to save souls or the work of Satan to lead them to perdition. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." Volume 1 of the Testimonies, pages 484 and 485. In Volume 3, on page 328, we are told, "There is no such thing now as a neutral position. We are all decidedly for the right or decidedly with the wrong." And so to try to maintain a neutral position, we may think that we're not really aiding or abetting either side of a controversy, a religious controversy. And Ellen White's not talking about whether the Germans and the French are going to go to war and we should side with one or the other. That's not the neutrality she's talking about. She's talking about spiritual neutrality, spiritual truth, spiritual doctrines. And we're not neutral, friends. We're either one way or the other. We may think that we're neutral. We may think that we're not going to get into this argument or fray, but by staying out of it, we are casting a vote for the side of Satan. Now, I thought you might find it interesting that for almost 90 years, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has had a very evangelical, ecumenical position toward how we view other teachings and how we can set sort of in a neutral position. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but in 1926, in the working policy, the General Conference, they voted this statement. We recognize every agency that lifts up Christ before man as a part of the divine plan for evangelization of the world, and we hold in high esteem Christian men and women in other communions who are engaged in winning souls to Christ. That's from the 1926 working policy. Today, the official statement is, we recognize those agencies that lift up Christ before man as a part of the divine plan for evangelization of the world, and we hold in high esteem Christian men and women in other communions who are engaged in winning souls to Christ. Virtually the same statement that we produced in 1926. And we say, well, you know, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? It sounds pretty good on the surface, doesn't it? How can you argue with anyone who's winning a soul to Christ? Can you? Is it the same Christ? Is it the same Christ? And are they presenting a Christ who asks you to walk in obedience to the commandments of God, including the fourth commandment? Do we really hold in high esteem the Pope or others that claim to be leading souls to Christ? This statement says that the church does. And yet, I suppose if we would take it at its most fundamental point, if this is really happening, how can we say no to that? But friends, this is not what's happening. Satan is using most of these evangelical churches, and I'm not pinpointing any one church here, but you know the truth is that he's using most of these evangelical churches to gather people as bundles to be burned. He's not gathering them in for heaven. Not all who claim to present Christ do so. What we need, friends, is the true gospel, the old rugged cross of John 3:16. That's what we need. Martin Luther called John 3:16 the heart of the Bible, the gospel in miniature. It is so simple that a child can understand it. But when you start getting into these views of God, these Trinitarian views of God that are mystical and mysterious, children can't understand those. Yet this truth is deep and marvelous, and it encompasses everything that we need to understand, if we could understand it properly. Who is God? God so loved the world. Who is God? Well, in this verse, he is the greatest lover. Because it says God so loved. But that is the greatest degree of love. And he loved the world, didn't he? The greatest number. God so loved the world that he gave the greatest act. And he gave his only begotten Son, friends, which is the greatest gift. That whosoever, the greatest invitation ever given. Whosoever believeth, the greatest simplicity. That whosoever believeth in him, the greatest person. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish. And that, friends, is the greatest deliverance. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but, that's the greatest difference. Isn't that the greatest difference? But have this greatest certainty. We may have everlasting life, the greatest possession. British evangelist G. Campbell Morgan, who was quite well known as a theologian and as a evangelist, was quite a generous man. He was known to give away much of what he had and to try to help others. But he said this. This was interesting. He says, this is a text referring to John 3:16. He says, I never attempted to preach on, though I have gone around it and around it. It is too big when I've read it and there is nothing else to say. If we only knew how to read it so as to produce a sense of it in the ears of people, there would be nothing to preach about. That's an interesting perspective. He said, I never tried to preach directly on this text. I've preached around it. I've talked about it so much. But he says, how do you preach this text? It's so self-evident. It's so there. It's so magnificent. But, let's see, we'll come back to that in a minute. But I did hear, I read about a preacher, a minister who made over 600 outlines on John 3:16. So one man said, I can't hardly preach on. Another man said, that's the only thing I can centrally preach on. Henry Morehouse began to preach when he was 16 years old. He died in his early manhood. And every time he stood up to preach, he said, my text today is John 3:16. Every time. The Son of God is important, friends. It's too important to water down and to insult Jehovah with false teachings about him. You see, friends, we have to decide what's truth. We need to understand what's truth about the identity of Jesus Christ. And we can't be neutral about it. We need to understand if he's really the Son of God or not. We need to understand what sin is. And not to be neutral, not say, well, sin can be this, and it can be this, and it can be this, and all these things, friends. We need to know if the Bible says there's one definition of sin, if the Spirit of prophecy over and over says there's one definition of sin for it, then we need to accept what inspiration says. You know, right now we see a lot of agitation, to be very blunt. We see a lot of agitation today about the issue of feast days. And should feast days be kept? Or can we work together with people who are keeping feast days? I'd just like to share with you a statement from the Review and Herald of June 14 of 1898. Speaking about the Lord's Supper, she says, "It was Christ's desire to leave to his disciples an ordinance that would do for them the very thing they needed, that would serve to disentangle them from the rites and ceremonies which they had hitherto engaged in as essential, and which the reception of the gospel made no longer of any force. To continue these rites would be an insult to Jehovah." Do you want to insult Jehovah? Do you want to help others to insult Jehovah? I mean, we need to figure out where we stand on these things, friends. You may read this statement. If you want to read it very differently than I do, and you want to interpret it differently than I do, I'll tolerate that. I'll give you the religious liberty even to do that. But don't deny the statement. It means something. Right? And every time we read a statement, whether it's 1 John 3:4, John 3:16, Romans 6:23, Romans 3:23, Galatians 5:4, no matter what we read, friends, they mean something. And we better figure out what they mean and quit being wishy-washy about what they mean. Not all who claim to believe the truth really do. In Volume 3 of the Testimonies, again on page 328, "Those who have, in the fear of God, ventured out to faithfully meet error and sin, calling sin by its right name, have discharged a disagreeable duty, with much suffering of feeling to themselves, but they get the sympathy of but few and suffer the neglect of many." It is not popular to proclaim that all are not teaching the truth. It's not a popular position. It's not an easy position. It's not one that's well loved. We are told in Testimonies of Ministers and Gospel Workers on pages 163 and 164, none are to stand in a neutral position. Let me just pause there. You know, we read earlier that really there is no such thing as a neutral position, but we think we're standing in a neutral position. But it says, none are to stand in a neutral position. All are to represent Christ in active, earnest effort to save perishing souls. Will the church fold her hands now? Shall we sleep, as is represented in the parable of the foolish virgins? Every precaution is to be taken now, for haphazard work will result in spiritual declension, and that day will overtake us as a thief. The mind needs to be strengthened to look deep and discern the reasons of our faith. The soul temple is to be purified by the truth, for only the pure in heart will be able to stand against the wiles of Satan. Jesus said that only the pure in heart will see God. Only those who are pure in heart will be able to stand against the wiles of Satan. And so, beloved, if it is the Word of God that purifies these hearts, then it behooves upon us to study the Word of God and to know what it means for ourselves and not to allow someone else to dictate what it is. I want to tell you today, friends, the best raspberries I ever ate in my life, I ate in Switzerland. They were good. These red, fresh raspberries. I've seen some of the most beautiful things in the world in Switzerland. Some of the people in Switzerland are very friendly. And to all my brothers and sisters in Switzerland who may hear this today, I apologize for all the remarks that may appear to be negative. But there's one thing that the Swiss are wrong on, and it's just this issue of neutrality. And they're wrong, and the ecumenical movement is wrong, and we cannot be a part of it, whether it's on a large scale or on a small scale. Do you understand what I mean by that? Whether it's on a large scale or whether it's on a small scale. And we are to remember, friends, that neutrality is a grievous sin. In Prophets and Kings on page 148, it says, the Lord abhors indifference and disloyalty in a time of crisis in his work. If I could pause just to mention that this section, page 148, is on Carmel. This is the background of what she's writing on, is Carmel. The whole universe is watching with inexpressible interest the closing scenes of the great controversy between good and evil. Now notice what she's done. She's shifted. She's made a shift from talking about the time of Elijah and using that as a principle, as a fundamental basis for how we understand the last days. The people of God are nearing the borders of the eternal world. What can be of more importance to them than that they be loyal to the God of heaven? All through the ages, God has had moral heroes, and he has them now. Those who, like Joseph and Elijah and Daniel, are not ashamed to acknowledge themselves as his peculiar people. His special blessing accompanies the labors of men of action, men who will not be swerved from the straight line of duty, but who with divine energy will inquire, who is on the Lord's side? Exodus 32:26. Men who will not stop merely with the inquiry, but who will demand that those who choose to identify themselves with the people of God shall step forward and reveal unmistakably their allegiance to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Such men make their wills and plans subordinate to the law of God. For love of him, they count not their lives dear unto themselves. Their work is to catch the light from the word and let it shine forth to the world in clear, steady rays. Fidelity to God is their motto. Do you remember Exodus chapter 32, what it's about? The golden calf apostasy? And you remember Moses said, who's on the Lord's side? And the Levites stood over and said, we are. And today, beloved, God is asking you, who's on my side? Are you on his side today? Are you willing to stand with fidelity? Are you willing not only to say, I'm on your side, but as the statement says, but will with themselves step forward and reveal unmistakably their allegiance to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? And will they demand others to identify themselves that we are with the people of God? And today, friends, I'm asking you, are you with the people of God or not? Is this your desire to be with the people of God and to do God's will and to follow his truth and whatever it brings us to? Because we know, according to the scriptures, we know there's coming a time of trouble such as never was. And we know there's coming a time, friends, we're going to lose everything that we have of this earth. Everything. And if we have to lose it early, what does it matter? If we lose all the support for the ministry and for the church, what does it matter if we've stood for Christ? It means nothing. It's not popular, friends. You know, I think, and I say this humbly based upon what I've seen in other places. Now, God can turn the spigot on. He can turn the spigot off. But there is a certain divine leniency that God allows certain people to walk certain paths. And he gives them that privilege to do that. And you can look at what certain, I'll just use this as an example because it's broad and it doesn't point the finger too terribly hard. But you look at a lot of the television church ministries. First of all, to be on television, they have to have money, right? Had to get some money somewhere to be on television, usually. But most of those ministries really aren't teaching the truth, and you know it as well as I do. And they're teaching things that many times are popular, or even if it's sort of narrowed down within a certain segment of their church population, it's popular. And they get good support, you know. And a minister, if he wants to, if he knows how to play the audience, and I say audience, not congregation. If he knows how to manipulate the minds and work the pocketbooks and say the things that please people, the money can come into the coffers pretty good. And it does. It does in a lot of places. Because the people are hearing what they want to hear. Friends, if you lose everything for preaching the truth, you've gained everything.
Amen.
You've gained everything. And today, friends, may it be our purpose to make sure that we understand what we believe and stand for it. Not to be neutral. Not to take a wishy-washy opinion about things. Not to tell people, well, you can get to the kingdom of God going this way, you can get to the kingdom of God going that way. We're all going to go there together. Just as long as you don't make your point dogmatic to me, as long as you don't make your appointment dogmatic to me, and we're all believe something that's fundamentally together enough to have unity. But unity, friends, is not based upon compromise. Unity is based upon truth. And may God's truth shine forth. Thank you.